going through the New Testament, and we're in the book of 1 Corinthians, and we've gone through several books. Today we will be getting to chapter 7, but before I do, I didn't quite get to finish a few verses of chapter 6, which actually go together with chapter 7. You got to understand that the chapter divisions that are in our scriptures were not added until hundreds and hundreds of years after the time that the scriptures were written. And so they're man-made, they're conveniences so that we can find the address of scriptures, chapter and verses are, but they don't necessarily have complete thoughts contained within each chapter like a normal book chapter would. So therefore, part of chapter 6 really goes with chapter 7. And so I'm starting in chapter 6 and verse 15, where it says, "Do you not know that your bodies are the members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of a harlot? Certainly not. Or do you not know that he who is joined to a harlot is one body with her? For the two, he says, shall become one flesh. But he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him." I want to talk for a moment because in our day and age, there's a general acceptance of fornication. And fornication is the Greek word that is actually, the word is porneia, the word that we get pornography from. It's not just pornography, porn with graph or graphic as the other part of the word. That implies porneia that is written or imaged. That's what pornography is. But porneia is the root word for illicit sexual activity. In other words, biblically speaking, it's any sex that happens outside of the bounds of marriage. Now, you'd think we wouldn't have to teach on that. We have at least junior high and up grades in here, and I'll try to keep it PG for sure. But it's something that whether you're single or married, all of us need to hear this message because porneia is rampant in our society. Sex sells, you better believe it. I remember being in California not too long ago. The best example I've seen of this ever was a lumber company that was advertising its lumber, and it said, "Got wood." And it the image was probably 60 or 70 feet of billboard of a giant naked woman laying sideways with her arms over her breasts, and the only thing covering the rest of her was her tool belt. Did it get my attention? Yes, it did. Why? Because God made me hardwired to notice such things about women. But it was the best example I've ever seen of sex sells. And is but that is so prevalent in our society. It's also something that is really excused in our society. You don't get a sexual revolution without beginning first to be lax in the areas of sexual conduct. You don't get demands for homosexuals to have the right to marry one another unless there's already a landscape of free sex already to begin with a landscape of porneia already laying the groundwork, where that sex among heterosexual people is so common and so accepted that it takes something extreme beyond that to even begin to get the attention of the public about issues that we just described. But the Bible calls us to holiness. The Bible calls us to be separate from the world. The Bible calls us to be like Christ. And Christ Jesus, our Lord, is faithful to us. Christ Jesus calls us, the church, the bride of Christ. Christ Jesus is faithful to us. We are not always faithful to Him, but He has called us to be faithful. And that imagery of Christ being faithful to us is what we in a marriage are called to be faithful to one another. And so when we give of ourselves sexually to others outside the bounds of marriage, then we cheapen the value of the committed relationship. And we break the understanding of the intimacy of the knowledge of God that He has designed for us. And so I encourage you, whether you're single or whether you're married, to take seriously not only your vows, or whether you haven't taken them yet, but your chaste conduct of yourself. For after all that Paul points out here, do you not know that your bodies are members are body parts of Christ. He's the head, we're the body parts. Don't you know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ, my body, and make it members of a harlot? Most certainly not, he says. Or do you not know that he who is joined with a harlot is one body with her, and the two, he says, shall become one flesh? That's quoting Genesis, where Adam knew his wife Eve, and they became one flesh. Do I have to explain that to you? That's not pornea. That is the coming together in a marriage situation and the consummating of that marriage physically. He says, when you act like you're consummating a marriage physically, but you're not in a marriage of commitment to that person, that's called pornea. That is when you begin to cheapen the value of the committed relationship to another. And he says, do you not know that you become one flesh for the time with that person? Do you not know that this is a level of intimacy that is way beyond the pale, beyond the norm? We pretend and act like it's no big deal. We talk about friends with benefits. And yet, it is so, we cheapen it and bring this one flesh concept down to just something physical as if it were outside our body, like a glove or something. And yet he says, do you know that the scripture says they'll become one flesh? He who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. And so he says, flee sexual immorality. Every sin that a man does is outside the body. If I steal, it's something I'm doing outside the body. If I kill, it's outside of my body. If I run from the cops, it's outside my body. If any kind of sin that I do, if I lie, if I steal, I cheat, all that it starts at me and extends outside my body. He says, but the sin of sexual immorality, he who commits sexual immorality sins against his own body, because you become one flesh with the person that you commit that adultery or that fornication with. And so he says in verse 18, here's the solution. Avoid sexual immorality. No? What does it say? Flee. You mean like the little thing that hops on my dog? You mean flee like run away? Like, yeah. Yeah, like when you boogie too much, you need to boogie away from this, right? Boogie, run. Flee sexual immorality. This is the only place in Scripture that it says to flee. When it talks about our enemies, we're supposed to be in victory, stand up against them. Only sexual immorality does it say that we should flee from. All of our sins are handled by the cross. All of our sins are under the blood. But he specifically says run from sexual immorality. Why? Because it is so easy to consume you. It's so easy to grab you. It's so easy to justify. We're going to get married anyway, after all. After all, what is marriage? It's just a piece of paper, right? Adam and Eve didn't have a piece of paper, did they? Nobody only had one wife. And God married them. Let me give you my definition, and this is my definition. I believe it's a biblical one. My definition of marriage. First of all, it's between a man and a woman. Not between a man and his dog or his buddy or anybody else, but it's between a man and a woman that has some kind of ceremony, whether it's jumping a broom or whether it's standing before a pastor or whether it's going to the justice of the peace, some kind of ceremony of commitment to one another consummated by sex. You can have sex, you can have any one of those three elements and it's not a marriage. You can have sex and it's not a marriage, it's fornication. You can have a piece of paper and it's only that. You can have commitment to one another, but never bother to go down and get the piece of paper, because there's no real commitment. And you can have people who have marriages of convenience to bring someone in from out of the country and never have any intention of actually living together as husband and wife and consummating the marriage. So you can have any one of those elements without, but unless you have all three of those elements come together, a commitment to one another, a ceremony, and a consummation of the marriage sexually, those three are required for marriage. And so as we begin to speak about these things, he says, flee sexual immorality. Every sin that a man does outside the body, he who commits sexual immorality sins against his own body. He says, or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you. Actually, they didn't know because this was the first time Paul wrote that. Now, we've heard it before. He's reminding us, but he's saying it for the first time to the Corinthians. He says, do you not know that your body is your body, okay, is the temple. What is a temple, by the way? We don't have temples today. We have churches, gathering places of Christians. In the Old Testament, they had temples. What was the purpose of the word temple? A temple is a physical place where God comes to meet with man. Now, there are heathen temples where people come and try to connect with their demon deities. And in the Old Testament, in the Jewish understanding of the word temple, there was a tabernacle, a tent, or the Temple of Solomon, or other temple where God himself in a pillar of fire rested over that holy place. And there people gathered to connect with and commune with God. It is a gathering place where God meets man. Now, in the New Testament, we understand that the Holy Spirit no longer comes to a geographic location, but now with the tongues of fire of Acts chapter 2, and the believers where tongues of fire settled upon each of the believers, it is an explanation, therefore, that the fire of God, the Holy Spirit of God, now dwells in each of us, and each of us is individually a temple of the Holy Spirit, who now, instead of dwelling above us like a pillar of fire, now dwells in us, in our heart. The Bible says he is sealed in our hearts unto the day of redemption. So in case you didn't get it, he said, did you not know that your body, say my body, is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in me? So your bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit who dwells in you. Now, that's not true for your unsaved neighbors or friends. It is true of you as a believer. And so he says, do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own? For you were bought at a price. What was the price? The blood of Christ on the cross was the price that God paid to buy your self, your body, soul, and spirit. Your spirit was dead, your soul was far from God, and your body was suffering the consequences of sin, which is death. He bought you body, soul, and spirit, and now he dwells in you, has made you new, bought you at a price, and therefore you don't have the right to do with your body whatever you want. Now, we talk a lot about rights in this country, women's rights, citizens' rights, the rights to do whatever the heck we want. We do not have the right to do whatever we want. We have the right to say yes or no to God. That's the only right we have. And if we don't say yes to God, that's not right. No pun intended. So you have one right, and that is the right to surrender to God who paid for you. That's the only right we have. So he says, in light of all that, don't treat your bodies as if they don't matter. They were made in the image of God. They are the dwelling place, even though they are physical, even though they get sick and die, even though they are sometimes diseased and they fail us, even though they are the tabernacle from which we will be delivered one day to receive a new body one day. For now, as you walk around in your physical body, your failing physical body is still the tent or tabernacle or temple of the Holy Spirit who dwells within you. And we are bought with a price. And so with that understanding, he goes into chapter 7 and he begins to talk about several different aspects of married and unmarried life. And so he takes on one at a time. So in verse 7, or chapter 7, he says, now concerning things of which you wrote to me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. Now let me talk about what that word touch means. Basically, it means don't touch. It means don't touch the merchandise. Amen. He says, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. Now, why did he say that, and what really did he mean by that? He meant pretty much what he said is what he meant. But that doesn't mean incidental contact. if you hand me a glass of water and my finger touches your hand, I don't, ah, unclean. You know, that's not what we're talking about. But the word touch here, there are multiple words in Greek for touch. This particular word for touch means to fasten onto or to lay hold of. Let me demonstrate. Come here, April. This is my wife. Now, if this is your wife, this is how I touch a woman. Okay? Hands, okay. Incidentals, okay. Now, if we just keep on holding hands, that could be a problem. Okay? But if I just touch her, that's okay. If I say, hey, how you doing? Good to see you. That's okay. You can touch the shoulder. Maybe pat on the back, maybe. If I start sliding down here, that's a little problem. Okay? If you start touching my wife here, we're going to have a problem. All right? There's very limited touch area, even in the allowable touch areas of a wife. Okay? Kiss me, darling. Mm-hmm. You don't do that. The Bible says greet the brethren with a holy kiss, not the sistren. Thank you, April. So he says, it is good for a man not to fasten onto or lay hold of, or in the Greek, its meaning is to touch with the purpose of changing it in some way. For instance, if you touch flame to kindling, the plan is that you ignite something. And if I touch April in a certain way, it's meant to ignite something. Okay, for all the adults in the room. If I touch you or your wife in that way and it's meant to ignite something, then we got a problem. So this is what it says here. Now concerning things which you wrote to me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman in this way. Nevertheless, because of sexual immorality or because of the danger of it, he says, let each man have his own wife and let each woman have her own husband. Now, the Greek word in there is actually let each male have his own wife and let each female have her own husband. I'm only bringing that up because there seems to be some gender confusion about that nowadays. It says, let each man, it means the female one or the male one, or the male person or the female person, let them have their own. Now verse 3, it says, let the husband, that's somebody who's married to a wife, okay? It says, let the husband render to his wife the affection due her, and likewise also the wife to her husband. Do I need to explain what that means? Okay, well, I probably do. First of all, the word affection is generously translated here in the New King James. The word actually is duty. Let the husband render to his wife the duty due her, and likewise also the wife the booty due him. Oh, did I say, I meant duty. Did I say the wrong word? My wife says that's bad. There are a few things to understand in this. First of all, ladies, as much as I'm going to try to teach your husband to be a romantic, he may not get it. He may not be good at it. He doesn't necessarily owe you, according to the scripture, affection, because the word is duty. It's talking about in physical romance, he says, let the husband render to his wife the duty of sexual relations. Do her, and likewise also the wife should render to the husband the physical affection or the duty of sexual intimacy that is due him. Now, people use sex as a weapon in marriage. You should never use sex as a weapon. My wife and I made it very clear before we got married, I will never sleep on the couch. I will never sleep on the couch. If my wife's so mad at me that she wants me to sleep on the couch, then it's welcome for her to go do the same. Okay? Now, that's not me being macho. What that is an understanding that there is something sacred about the physical union that we have that should never be used as a weapon or a tool. And even if you're not getting along well, it may be that you might need to do a little something. Might serve to ease the tension some. The teenagers are like, I'm not looking at anybody. Hope he doesn't look at me. That's okay. You'll be there one day. Obey this. Things will go better. Do not confuse sex and politics. Sex and argument. Sex and love. This is love making. That's true. It is an appropriately used word, term. But if you come into a conflict and things aren't perfect between you, try to work on this and maybe the rest will come a little bit. And the reason why is should be evident. It keeps us from fornication. Let the husband render his wife the affection due her and all, likewise the wife to the husband. The wife does not have authority over her own body, but the husband does. Huh. How many times those guys are like, hey, you get headache? I'll go get some meds for you. I got some Tylenol right here, baby. The wife does not have authority over her own body, but the husband does. And likewise, the husband does not have authority over his body, but the wife does. That's a mutual submission to one another in the oneness of marriage that is due to one another. Verse 5 says, do not deprive one another. Do not deprive one another. I'd like to make you say that out loud, but you know, I won't do that. Do not deprive one another. That's the command of Scripture. Except, there is an exception, with consent for a time. Not now, honey. Give me some space for a time, but I will not deprive you permanently. With consent for a time, and he gives the example, that you may give yourselves to fasting and prayer. So, if your husband won't leave you alone, ladies, could be that going to prayer meeting would be a way to remedy that situation. But he says, for fasting and prayer, he says, you say no to the flesh desires, just like saying no to the belly. So you say no to sexual appetite for the purpose of fasting and prayer. He says, other than that, he says, and then come back together. Come together. Say together. Come together again so that Satan does not tempt you because of your lack of self-control. Now, if you all had perfect self-control, we wouldn't have to worry about this, but we're all practicing that, aren't we? He says, don't give an avenue for Satan. We should all have self-control. But he says, to keep Satan at bay, to make him pick on other people for other things, don't let this become a problem in your home. And so, verse 6 says, I say this as a concession, not as a commandment. For I wish that all men were even as I myself, meaning single. Paul was single. But each one has his own gift from God, one in this manner and another in that. By the way, the gifts of the Spirit are listed. You know, some of those are tongues, prophecy, gifts of giving, gifts of ministries, hospitality, faith, because all kinds of spiritual gifts. I don't read anywhere in there the gift of celibacy. But apparently, according to Paul, it is a gift from God that some can be celibate. Celibate meaning I am not having sexual relations with anybody and will not get married. That's what celibacy is. And so he says some people have given that gift. Probably Paul had that gift. And he says, not as a commandment. Let each one have his own gift from God, verse 7, one in this manner, one in that. But I say to the unmarried and to the widows, it is good for them if they remain even as I am. Again, unmarried. Verse 9, but if they cannot exercise self-control, let them marry, for it is better to marry than to burn with passion. So better to marry than to burn is what it was in the old King James. And we used to say, wow, better to get married than to burn in hell for having sex with my girlfriend before I got married. That's pretty scary. And sometimes the preacher would let us think that's what it meant because, you know, a little additional help there doesn't hurt, right? Trying to keep people separate. But it says that if you cannot have self-control in the area of sexual activity, then get married for crying out loud. Now, don't let that be the number one choice as to why or who you marry. But if you're in a relationship with a Christian man or woman, and you love one another, and it looks like it's going to lead to the commitment to one another of marriage anyway, don't put off, don't have long engagements. That's all I got to tell you. Long engagements are a tool of Satan, let me hear to tell you. Right, April? Terrible, terrible burden to have to wait a long time before we got married. I'll leave that alone. Get your mind back in the scriptures, amen. Better to marry than to burn with passion. Verse 10, now to the married I command, and yet not I, but the Lord. A wife is not to depart from her husband. We're talking about leaving each other in a divorce situation. Now, let me clarify that we could go to other scriptures that would clarify that if you are being treated as a punching bag by your husband at home, get out. Okay? The scripture does not demand that you stay and be a punching bag. If the husband or wife is not providing for you, and I mean like completely not providing, total abandonment of the duty of husband or wife, there is a time and a place to separate for your good and perhaps for the good of your family, for the sake of danger and so forth. But we're talking here about just simply interpersonal relationship issues here in this particular case. It says, now to the married I command, yet not I the Lord, a wife is not to depart from her husband, but even if she does depart, let her remain unmarried or be reconciled to her husband, and a husband is not to divorce his wife. And we'll say more about that at the end of this chapter, so I'm just going to leave that alone for a moment. Let me point out where it says, let her remain unmarried or be reconciled. That's the choices. To her husband, because the husband is not to divorce his wife. It says, but to the rest, I, not the Lord, say, if any brother has a wife who does not believe, and she is willing to live with him, let him not divorce her. Let's say you're married to an unbeliever, and you can't get that lousy husband of yours to darken the door of the church, even on Mother's Day. You can't get him to come to the Christmas pageant to see the kids. He's just a total heathen, but he is faithfully married to you in a mutually monogamous relationship. What do? Ditch him? Say, hey, you Gentile heathen dog, you get out of my home, get out of my life? No. You stay married to him. He says, if any brother has a wife who does not believe and she is willing to live with him, let him not divorce her. Verse 12. And then verse 13. And a woman who has a husband who does not believe, if he is willing to live with her, let her not divorce him. Because that was a belief. Now I'm married. I'm the bride of Christ. My husband's a Gentile heathen dog. Should I get rid of him? No. You were married. That's why I believe that a marriage before the justice of the peace that's not in a church is still a legitimate marriage. Now, if you want to go to church and get married before God, that's great. But in the eyes of God, He still holds us accountable for the vows we make to each other before men. And so that is a legitimate marriage, even if it is not in a church setting. And so to verse 14 says, for the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband. Otherwise, your children would be unclean, but now they are holy. The implication here is that if I'm married to my heathen Gentile dog husband, and he's not a believer, so this can't be a real marriage before God, then my children must be illegitimate. There's words for that I won't use this time, but you can find it in the Old King James very plainly. But your children are not illegitimate, according to the scriptures here, if you are willing to stay married in the physical realm of this earth and your children are not fatherless, shall we say. That not unclean but holy. Verse 15. But if the unbeliever departs, let him depart. Whoa! If the unbeliever departs, let him depart. A brother or a sister is not under bondage in such cases. But God has called us to a peaceful relationship. What does that mean? That means if your husband is a heathen Gentile dog, and he leaves, walks out, are you stuck married to that slob who's not taking care of you, who's treating you mean, and perhaps is having illicit relationships with all other kind of women out there, or not? No, you're not stuck with that. Let him go. But what if he's saved? Oh, don't let him go. But if he's not saved, let him go. Well, he didn't act like he's saved. Well, I can just let him go. No, if he claims to be a believer, you take him at his word. You two need to reconcile, even though he walks out on you. But if he is a genuine unbeliever, a true heathen, then the scripture says, you're free, let him go. That's what Paul says. A brother or sister is not under bondage in such cases, but God has called us to peace. Verse 16, for how do you know a wife or whether you will save your husband? How do you know, O husband, whether you'll save your wife? He says, if the heathen husband or wife is pleased to live with you, don't throw them out. Don't walk away from them. Don't show them that you can break covenant. Because aren't we trying to teach that God is a God of covenant who never breaks his promises? You, the believer, should never break your vows or promises to God. If the heathen departs, let him depart. But you should never be the one who departs in that case. Who knows? You might save the husband or wife eventually by watching your conduct before God. Verse 17, but as God has distributed to each one, as the Lord has called each one, so let him walk. And I ordain this in all the churches. Was anyone called while circumcised? Now this is moving on to different relational situations. He's talking about how people were before they got saved. Now listen to this. As God has distributed to each one, verse 18, was anyone called while circumcised, meaning Jewish? Let him not become uncircumcised. To the New Testament believer who was Jewish before and became a Jewish Christian, keep on being a Jewish Christian. Keep the holidays. Keep your Jewish holidays and your connections with your Jewish friends. There's nothing wrong with that. Use that as a way to bring them into the faith in the Messiah, Jesus Christ. Doesn't mean we have to be bound by the law, but it says keep it up. Verse 18, was anyone called while uncircumcised, meaning you're a Gentile? Let him not suddenly decide I need to be religious and get circumcised. Circumcision is nothing. An uncircumcision is nothing. But keeping the commandments of God is what matters. Verse 20, let each one remain in the same calling in which he was called. Were you called while a slave? Do not be concerned about it. But if you can be made free, rather use it. By the way, the Apostle Paul is accused, and the Bible is accused by unbelievers sometimes of promoting slavery. And certain key verses, like the one I'm reading, were used by unscrupulous masters in the 1800s and 1700s to try to keep their slaves biblically and morally under their thumb, even though slavery was an immoral situation. So people can twist the scriptures. But that's not what Paul's talking about. Paul is not talking about keeping people in slavery. What he said is, if you're a slave before you got saved, then you can be a slave after you're saved. If you're free before you get saved, you can be free after you're saved. But look how he addresses it. He says, but if you are a slave, were you called while a slave? Verse 21, do not be concerned about it. But, if you can be made free, run! Go for it! He says, slaves, be obedient to your own masters just as you would to Christ. But if there's an opportunity for you to either buy your freedom or to be set free, he says, use it and become free. And then verse 22, he who is called in the Lord while a slave is the Lord's freedman. You can be free on the inside. We tell this to prisoners in jail all the time. Person might be in jail for life, but they can get saved and they can be free in Christ even though they are incarcerated on the outside. He who is called in the Lord while a slave is the Lord's freedman. Likewise, he who is called while he is free is Christ's what? Oh. That's why the slave is encouraged to be okay with his current state. He says, be free if you can. He says, but the truth is, we're all slaves to Christ. And if we can obey Christ, our Lord, then let us demonstrate that by being obedient to our own masters on the earth, whether that be a slavery situation or a boss situation with a job. But he says, we are all slaves to Christ, who is our good master. He says, you were bought with a price. Ooh, that sounds like slavery. Ooh, it does, doesn't it? and I am a slave to Christ. And I'm not ashamed to say that I'm a slave to Christ, because He is a good master, and He paid dearly for me, and He takes good care of me. And He is not a man that He should lord over me, but He is a good, good God who has taken me from slavery and has called me, Christ called me brother, and now I am called a child of God. What a benefit. What a benefit from slave to son in Christ. Brethren, let each one remain with God in the state in which he was called. We got to finish up because I heard a beep while ago, which probably means I'm out of time. I'm going to finish up. Verse 25. Now concerning virgins. Now this is male or female virgins. And in the Greek, virgin means virgin. It means I'm primarily not married in that culture, implying, of course, sexual purity as well. It says, now concerning male and female virgins, I have no commandment from the Lord, yet I give judgment as one whom the Lord in His mercy has made trustworthy. By the way, Paul was honest enough to say, this is from the Lord, and this is my opinion. Any preacher who does not do the same is being dishonest. If it's just my opinion, and I know that it's just my opinion, I'm going to tell you, this is my opinion, but this is what the Scripture says. And that's what Paul's doing here. Paul says, I think everybody ought to be single. But that's not me. That's not from the Lord. That's just me. Nevertheless, concerning virgins, I have no commandment from the Lord, yet I give judgment as one whom the Lord in His mercy has made trustworthy. I suppose, therefore, that this is good because of the present distress. In other words, things are so bad that it is good not for a man to remain as he is. That it is good for a man to remain as he is. Are you bound to a wife? Do not seek to be loosed. Maybe this is an answer from the Lord for some of you. You've been praying about this. Consider this the answer. Do not seek to be loosed from your wife. Are you loosed from a wife? Do not seek a wife. Sorry, ladies. If you're single, don't seek to be married. If you're married, don't seek to be single. He says, but even if you do marry, you have not sinned. And if a virgin marries, she is not sinned. Nevertheless, such will have trouble in the flesh, but I would spare you. Paul says, you're going to get married, you're going to have trouble. I'm just telling you, just warning you ahead of time, but it's not a sin. If you want to jump into that, you go right ahead. For this I say, brethren, that the time is short, that from now on, even those who have wives should be as though they had none. Those who weep, act as if they did not weep. Those who rejoice, act as if they did not rejoice. Those who buy, act as though they did not possess. And those who use this world, act as if you were not misusing it. For the form of this world is passing away. Now, he says, in other words, there's troubled times coming. Don't be too dependent on anything in the world. Verse 32 says, but I want you to be without care. He who is unmarried cares for the things of the Lord, how he may please the Lord. But he who is married cares about the things of the world, how he may please his wife. Is that true? I can tell you right now, if I wasn't married to my wife, I wouldn't be paying that big old payment on my house. Now, do I enjoy my house? Sure I do. I guarantee you I'd have me some paid-for camper somewhere, and I'd be cruising around dragging my Harley behind me somewhere. My priorities would be different. My cares would be different. But you please the husband or wife in a relationship, and that's appropriate. But our house, our time, our attention are appropriately drawn away by our spouse. If your husband or your wife is complaining that you're spending too much time down at that church, listen to your spouse. And then tell them, forget you. Go ahead and go. You have to find the happy balance between serving the Lord and being a servant to your spouse. What is the dividing line? I don't know. You just got to find it. That's what the Lord says to do. Verse 34, there is a difference between a wife and a virgin. The unmarried woman cares about the things of the Lord, that she may be holy both in body and in spirit. But she who is married cares about the things of the world, how she may please her husband. Same speech. And this I say for your own profit, not that I may put a leash on you, but for what is proper, that you may serve the Lord without distraction. And maybe where the first initial nuns came from, and the idea of priests being not married may have originally come from, some of this thinking. But if anyone, any man or anyone, thinks he is behaving improperly toward his virgin or his daughter, if she is past the flower of her youth, in other words, if you're a poor girl, she's 25 and you still got her at home and she's not married yet and she's ugly as sin, but it's time to let that girl go, let him do what he wishes. He does not sin. Let them marry. Let them marry, poor girl. Nevertheless, he who stands steadfast in his heart, having no necessity, in other words, she's not over 25, ugly as sin, and can't find a boyfriend, having no necessity, but has power of his own will, and has determined in his heart that he will keep his virgin, he does well. In other words, guys, if your daughter wants to get married, and she's dead set on it, okay, you don't really have the right to hold on to her, but you do have the right to say, not that one. Not him. I'll let you get married, but not that one. Okay? That's the right of fathers.
Now you tell me.
Yeah. So then he who gives her in marriage, Sam Pavlock, does well. Never mess with a man with a microphone. You ought to know that. But he who does not give her in marriage does better. All right, last passage. Our last section, and I'm going to look at one other passage and we're done. A wife is bound by the law as long as her husband lives. But if her husband dies, she is at liberty to be married to whom she wishes, only in the Lord. In other words, don't just marry anybody. It's got to be a Christian. But she is happier if she remains as she is, according to my judgment. Oh, and I think I have the Spirit of the Lord. So Paul's like, you know, this is my opinion, but I'm pretty sure the Lord gave me this. I'm pretty sure the Lord gave it to him too. But let me help you some of those, because marriage and divorce, I want to turn to one more scripture that Jesus himself spoke as it talks about marriage and divorce. It says, a man is bound by, back in 1 Corinthians, it says, a wife is bound by the law as long as her husband lives, but if her husband dies, she is at liberty to be married whom she wishes, only in the Lord. Let's see what the Lord himself spoke about that in Matthew chapter 19, verses 8 and 9. I'll start in verse 8. He said to them, Moses, because of the hardness of your hearts, permitted you to divorce your wives. But from the beginning it was not so. Verse 9. And I say to you, this is Jesus himself, our master, our Lord. I say to you, whoever divorces his wife, except for sexual immorality, and marries another, commits adultery. What? Even if I'm married to her? Yep. No, I'm in the right place. I'm sorry. It's chapter 19, verse 9. I'm not sure what I gave. I'm sorry. So it's chapter 19, verse 9. And I say to you, whoever divorces his wife, except for sexual immorality, and marries another, commits adultery. And whoever marries her who is divorced, commits adultery. Ooh, that's rough. So a man and his wife get divorced, and either of those parties marry someone else. He said, Jesus said, you're committing adultery. Sorry. And you go, I'm an adulterer. I'm an adulteress according to the scriptures. That's terrible. Wait. What did he say? What did he actually say? He says, I say to you, whoever divorces his wife except for sexual immorality and marries another commits adultery. Let me explain it like this. And now I'm going to tell you, this is my opinion based on the scriptures and my study. Okay, everybody got that? It's my opinion. All right. It's my opinion based on what Jesus said, what Paul said, and my total understanding of scripture. That once you marry, God recognizes that marriage. Once you divorce, that is a man-made paper. God still sees you as married, even though you are separated. Even though there is a bill of divorce written, in his eyes, you are still married. If either party, and hear me clearly, if either party marries another, they have adulterated the marriage. That person commits an adultery. You do not. But that adulteration of the marriage ends that marriage right there. Jesus said, except in the area of immorality or in sexual immorality. So here's the deal. You have an exclusive covenant with your married partner, recognized by law, with a covenant of relationship consummated by marriage. When you adulterate the marriage by either party doing immorality, having sex with someone outside that marriage, you adulterate that marriage. That doesn't mean you have to end the marriage. There is forgiveness. There is restoration. And thank God for many of us, there is restoration. Amen. Thank God our spouses are still willing to put up with us sometimes when we really screw up. There is forgiveness available, and that continues that marriage covenant right on. But if in the case of adultery, that adulterates the marriage, and either, he says, then you're free. Either party can walk out at that point because you have broken the covenant of marriage. He says, if you're just mad at your wife, you're just mad at your husband, and you divorce, that piece of paper don't mean a thing. I still see you as married. If either one of you marries someone else, you adulterate that first marriage. Now, it doesn't mean you're adulterer for the rest of your life. It doesn't mean you're adulterer with your second wife. Many people in here, and I'm not looking at anybody, and I don't want to know your past. You may be working on your second or third marriage. You are not continuously adulterer because you are with your current wife. That is now the new covenant. That is now the new holy matrimony that God has placed you in, or you have placed yourself in before God. So do not think that you are continuously an adulterer because you have married a new wife. You were divorced in some kind of terrible thing early in your life. You both moved on. You both married other people. Should you divorce your new wife and go back and marry your old one? No, God forbid, Paul says. Should you divorce your husband and go back to... No, God forbid. He says, whatever state you are in, stop. Just stop the madness. If you have remarried and your spouse had not either had sex outside of that marriage or never remarried, and you did, then you adulterated your first marriage. Sorry, there is forgiveness. But your new marriage is not adultery before God. Your new marriage is a new covenant. Am I clear on that? So do not look at your new wife or your new husband and say, dude, we're living in adultery. No, you're not. You have made a new covenant, but you adulterated the first one. And so that's the way that goes. If either party has not adulterated the marriage, then the scriptural mandate is to come back together and unify and reinstitute that marriage. But if either party in the separation or before the separation or after the separation engages in sexual activity outside of that marriage, then you are no longer bound by the marriage, although forgiveness is always available and probably the first choice. Now, if you have any specific questions about that, my counseling door is open for that. I would like to explain to you in closer detail if you're worried about that or you're not sure about what I talked about or you missed something, maybe you should listen to the online version of this on YouTube, maybe hear it again. But I'm here to tell you, if you have been divorced, if you've been a victim of divorce, and your partner has moved on sexually or in marriage, you are free. And if you yourself moved on and have gotten married, you are not continuously adultery. You are in a new covenant relationship of faithfulness with your new spouse. That's what I understand the scriptures to say between what Jesus said and what Paul said and the sum total of it. And whatever state you're in, there is grace and forgiveness. No one should walk... Yeah, maybe need to get married. Nobody needs to walk out of here condemned. There is a Savior. Now I'm way out of time. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes just for a moment?